Today we're talking about net neutrality, the only time it's still hip to call the internet the net. Just saying that name has me thinking back to booting up Netscape to play some RuneScape. A very specific demographic of you out there is gonna get that reference. So why am I talking about net neutrality today? Is there a rule that every YouTube news comedy channel has to complain about this issue once a year, and I just need to pay my dues? Well, not quite. On Tuesday, yeah, I'm a little late to the game on this one, a federal appeals court largely upheld the Federal Communication Commission's repeal of the Obama-era net neutrality rules, but knocked down the agency's attempt to bar states from issuing their own net neutrality regulations. The news responded forcefully and aggressively by running, I don't know, probably something else about the Ukraine. On today's episode, I'm going to try to answer the simple question of, what does this ruling mean? And what, if anything, will happen next? Anyways, let's get started. Now there are two main changes this rule makes to internet law. First, it looks at the Obama-era FCC rules that were repealed regarding net neutrality and says, that's A-OK. But, like all online agreements, there's some very important and confusing fine print. It opens up the door to state-by-state regulation of internet providers.
A federal appeals court has upheld the Federal Communications Commission's repeal of net neutrality rules, for the most part. The caveat? The ruling banned the FCC from prohibiting states from making their own net neutrality laws.
Hoo-wee! Don't worry if you have no idea what was just said. The first time I saw that clip, my brain told my ears, you're on your own on this one. So let's break this down into two parts. First, what was the Obama regulation that was repealed? Well, the rules had prohibited broadband internet providers like Comcast and AT&T from blocking websites or charging for higher quality service or certain content. Now I know what you're thinking, why would my internet provider block or throttle content? They're Comcastic. Well, luckily for us, there was a time before Obama passed these rules, so we can actually totally see what was happening. Most of the content blocking came from an anti-competition angle. A perfect example of this is AT&T, Sprint, and Verizon all coming together to block Google Wallet from being supported on their services, because they were working on their own online wallet.
Yet another reason not to carry your wallet. Following in the footsteps of PayPal and Google Wallet is a virtual mobile wallet app called ISIS.
Huh, I wonder why that brand didn't stick around. Can I ISIS you that money? Now while it is funny, until 2013, Google couldn't run their app on any of these telecommunication providers' services. Similarly, from 2007 to 2009, AT&T forced Apple to block Skype and other competing voice over internet phone services on the iPhone. Because why would anyone pay for phone services when you can make a free Wi-Fi call? Better stop making that an option. Now there are a lot of examples of these anti-competitive things happening, but then you get to the more scandalous examples. For example, in 2005, service provider Telus began blocking access to a server that hosted a website supporting a labor strike against that company. Hey, it's only Big Brother if the government's doing it. Otherwise, good business. From the span of 2013 to very recently, pending an appeal case, this was illegal. Now this should be a lot more interesting nowadays with more corporate consolidation and the rise of streaming services. Take for example, NBC owns Comcast and is launching their own streaming service. Maybe they've just slowed down Netflix a little, so the strangest thing you'll be seeing is that loading circle. Oh wow, these are loading times straight out of the 80s. How immersive. At this point, many of you are probably thinking, well, that sounds like a terrible idea. Why would a court give it the thumbs up? Well, the legal question is, does the FCC have the right to do this? If you want to ask why the FCC would want to do this, that is a question for a year ago, when, well, they did it.
Commissioners just voted on the future of how the internet is going to be regulated. A panel voted along party lines to repeal what's called net neutrality. The Obama-era regulations were designed to keep the internet open and fair. Republicans, though, argue the rules stifle innovation. Once again, the FCC voting along party lines 3-2 to repeal net neutrality.
The question the FCC has been flip-flopping over between Bush, Obama, and Trump was whether to regulate high-speed internet delivery as if it were a utility like a phone service. Now this is where I want to clarify one point. I know everyone thinks of their phone as a camera, a computer, a web browser, an email messenger, and an instant messenger, but it turns out it can make calls too. The ability for it to make a phone call is managed as a utility still. But data, the part of your phone that connects it to the internet and everything else, is lumped in with broadband regulations. So the court took a look at the FCC's vote to deregulate mobile data and broadband and said, yeah, they can do that. Sounds like an out-and-out defeat for consumers though, right? Well, this is where something strange happened, because as I mentioned above, there's a second part to this case. You see, while this case was half about whether the FCC had a right to end net neutrality, an argument that was pretty doomed from the start, it was also about whether California had a right to put in their own net neutrality regulations to avoid throttling or blocking sites and apps in their state.
What the FCC tried to do in its repeal is to say no state can pass a law that puts net neutrality in place in their state. We are preempting those states from doing so. And the court said, uh-uh. The court said, if you, FCC, have decided to abdicate your oversight of broadband, you can't also tell the states that they can't regulate broadband.
The federal government is no longer regulating internet providers' regulation of the internet. Instead, it's up to the states. Literally the day after this ruling, my state, New York, crafted their own net neutrality regulations. At present, 34 states and the District of Columbia have introduced some kind of open internet legislation. So that's what happened this week in net neutrality news. If this video was laggy, it's because they don't want you to know the truth. So that's everything you need to know. But before we go, I want to discuss one final point to just give you the whole picture. Because, believe it or not, there are two sides to this story. Hey, I have to be neutral on net neutrality. Why would the FCC not want to regulate net neutrality? Well, there are a few reasons. First, the most compelling, in my opinion, arguments that for whatever reason the FCC chose not to use. Some would say emergency and health services, for instance, should always enjoy priority. In the purest form of net neutrality, emergency responders would be competing for limited broadband directly with someone on Pornhub, really just trying to make the best out of their entire neighborhood burning down. Similarly, some wonder exactly why bandwidth-hungry offerings such as Netflix should get a free ride. Not to bite the hand that feeds me, but some would look at these sites that stream videos and say, wow, you guys are taking up a ton of bandwidth. That isn't free, you know? You should really have to pay some sort of premium. Netflix actually came out very strongly against this repeal of net neutrality. I mention this because with soon 50 states writing 50 different internet regulation rules, these problems are all going to be addressed to varying degrees depending on region. Fortunately for us, those weren't the arguments that the FCC used, or else there might be some sort of moral gray area. Instead, they went with the old...
Ajit Pai believes that these rules are discouraging basically investment in new networks, and being able to provide faster online access in remote locations is pretty important stuff right now.
It's basically just saying everything I've said in this episode except with a smile on your face. This will make internet service providers a ton of money, and guess what? They're going to invest that money into improving their services. Unfortunately, most of the publications I read in preparation for this episode said that hasn't happened. At the same time, he said that the rules limit customer choice because telecom companies cannot offer different tiers of service. For example, As a result, he said, internet service companies cannot experiment with new business models that could help them compete with the online businesses like Netflix, Google, and Facebook. Not sure why you'd want a service provider competing with an online business. I mean, that sounds like a hard-to-mess-up recipe for disaster, but sure. Here's the interesting thing, though. That hasn't really happened either. In fact, nothing has really happened since this was repealed. Now that the regulation is going to be a patchwork of state-by-state laws, though, the bureaucracy will probably prevail, because any revenue you make from limiting access to competitors will have to be spent on lawyers. Well, we can do this in Wyoming, but don't even try to do it in Montana. And all of this completely illegal on both coasts. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube. Quick FYI, this is the last episode I'm releasing before I fly home to go backpacking through the countryside with my mom. Boy, did I pick an annoying time to schedule a vacation. We're now moving troops out of Syria, and for my opinion on that, I recently made a video about the situation in Syria. And just add to the end of that video, and then all the Americans left for the update. And it turns out the Democrats have just subpoenaed Trump's tax returns. For my opinion on that, I made a video a while back about the fight to get Trump's taxes. And add to the end of that video, now there's an impeachment inquiry. Here are the two links for those videos. Back to my normal spiel. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.